Well, it's been about a year since we've last been here, and a lot has happened. And we're getting ready for the kingdom of God to expand. Amen?
Yes.
Because Tiffany is pregnant. So it's going to expand by about, what, 12, 18, 19 inches come month or two? Amen? Well, it was in December that me and Shiny, we were at their house. And my wife was just talking about it this morning on the ride in. She said, I can't believe Tiffany cooked Indian food for me. Like, how nice is that? That she would actually make all those dishes for me. Wow. I said, yeah, she's the only person that's a non-Indian that ever cooked Indian food for you. And we really enjoyed it. We were like blown away. So we had a great meal. It was so elaborate. She outdid Indian families, let me tell you. We were shocked. She probably was shocked too. So we were enjoying, then we went into the living room and we did some worship. And we just were seeking the Lord in His presence. And, you know, God says that He looks for those who worship Him in spirit and truth. So many of us were looking for the Lord. If we just worship Him, He comes looking for us. Amen? So in the middle of worship, I got a vision. And it was a vision of Tiffany holding a baby. And when we stopped worshiping, I said, I have to release this. But God just showed me a vision of you holding a baby, and it's yours. Let it go. Several months later, Pastor Michael got in touch and said, Tiffany was pregnant. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God is faithful. And you know, when God puts those things on our heart, we just have to release it. I didn't feel any pressure. I didn't feel that, oh my gosh, what is this? It was there. God has given me visions. I'm a seer in the realm of the spirit. I use that to build the body of Christ. When God wants to encourage somebody, I do it. This morning I saw some things. When she was out here worshiping, I could see the fire on her. And the Holy Spirit was just saying, burn, burn, burn. Because when the people see you, they're going to see you burning. And they're going to come up and they're going to wonder what is going on in her life. Because people that are not coming to the church today are not looking for a sermon preached. They're looking for a sermon lived. Yes. So when they come up to you, because they're seeing it, then you can release the word of God to them. That's for Maureen. Also, I got a vision of Pastor Michael. He was up on a stage, and God told me that this is going to be his church. This is temporary, this place right here for you guys. And it was a hardwood floor, kind of like a brownish floor, and there was a clear podium up there. And I just felt like the Holy Spirit was saying that just prepare. He's moving you out of here. He's going to take you places. I also heard the word activation, that God was saying that He's activating gifts of the Spirit in this church, in this very season. You're in a season of that. He said He's not looking for those that give them a little bit of their heart. He's not even looking for the people that give half their heart. But He's looking for those that are going to give them all their heart. He's releasing new things to you. He's saying, step out in the spirit, step out. My church has been blinded. My church has become weak because they've turned away from the things that I have sent to them to give them the power to accomplish my will. This man right here, God is just saying, your name is success. He's saying right now that there was something that had happened in the past. And he's saying he already forgave you for that. That you're wearing a title around your neck as if it's like a chain. And he wants you to take that off. Don't wear those titles anymore. He's grieved by that. He's sad. He said the titles that he wants you to wear are that you're a son. That you are forgiven. That you have favor. And that you're a new creation. Amen. That's what he wants you to walk in. This girl all the way in the back, to the far left. Kimmy, can you just raise your hand? Just so I know that you know this word is for you. God is saying that He has set you apart. He has separated you. That sometimes you try to blend in with the other kids, but something feels different. He's saying that's because you're separated, like Jeremiah was separated, called to be a prophet. You see, sometimes God is trying to get our attention, and we don't see it. So let me just give a quick sermonette on that, because most of the time today I want to share all the amazing, awesome updates that God's doing through this ministry that I get to be a part of. How can I ever forget? This is my beautiful wife. I make sure she's the first one on the slide. See, I'm learning a little bit, huh? I'm learning because she deserves it. So this is my wife, Shiny, and this is my son, Jace. And so we do the ministry thing together. There's no separation of church and state in this household. When you do the ministry, the first ministry is to your wife or to your family.
Right.
If you're a wife, it's to your husband.
That's right.
And then to your kids. Otherwise, it will get backwards, and then it's unbiblical, and you just run into a lot of unnecessary problems. It's easy to go 8,000 miles across the world and preach to somebody, but can you live it for your family?
Right.
I'm still trying. I'm still pressing in. I get on my knees and I ask God for His grace because I have a long way to go, a long way. But I'm trying. Holy Spirit's helping me. Looks like my wife has a little smile today. It is. The original name of the company FedEx was the Federal Express Corporation. It was founded back in 1973 by a man named Fred Smith. And in the 90s, everybody would call it FedEx. Oh, I'm going to FedEx this to you. So finally, they caved in as a company, and they changed the name to FedEx. In the year 2000. So, they had to get a new logo. So they put out to all these graphic design marketing firms to get a new logo, and they narrowed it down to about 200. So they go into the conference room, and they have all the logos laid out over here, and they're thinking this is going to be a very tedious process how to pick one, right? So here comes Fred Smith. He is the founder and he's the CEO. He walks in and he says, there's 200. He says, I like that one. The one with the white arrow between the E and the X. I bet many of you didn't notice that. That arrow stands for speed and precision. It's a subliminal message that FedEx is sending to you. Do you know FedEx is way ahead of UPS? There was a time when Fred Smith almost had to give up. He had $5,000 in the company account. And he took that $5,000, and where did he go? Vegas, because the bank wouldn't approve him for a loan. So he said, okay, I'm going to gamble this company. Here it is, my last $5,000. Well, today, they're a billion-dollar company. Number one in the world. And if you look at worldwide, worldwide profits they made, it's in the trillions. See, we're living in the last days. As a prophet, God gives me discernment what's going on today in the world. And He showed me that one verse that really sticks out is Acts 2:17. And I believe that this is relevant for the year 2017. That Spirit says that I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Amen? On you, on you, on you, and on you. All people. You see, not long ago, I was in India. And you guys were over here having so much fun buying these solar eclipse sunglasses and trying to get them from Amazon. And I see the post, oh, hey, Sally, can I borrow your glasses? And does anybody have an extra pair? I said, oh, missing out. This looks like a lot of fun because the solar eclipse could be seen from the East Coast all the way to the West Coast in America. It was a countrywide extravaganza that was happening. I'm thinking, oh man, what a time to be in India. can tell you, after that eclipse, that's when all the madness began. Amen? Because then right after that, we had a hurricane called Irma that hit Florida. Well, do you know what day that hurricane landed? It landed on a Sunday to disrupt church as normal. Too many Christians today have become complacent. See, we're not commanded to make converts. No, but we are commanded to share the gospel. That's what they did for in the book of Acts. That's what Jesus told us to do. Well, it wasn't long after Irma that hit Florida. Right after that, another hurricane came in. And guess what day that hit? Sunday, again. Maybe God was trying to say something to us. I think he was saying, I was whispering at first, but I couldn't get your attention. Remember what I said, God's trying to get our attention, and sometimes we don't see it. Well, where did it hit in Texas? Now this is where it gets really interesting. It hit a place called Corpus Christi, where it touched down. But then I did a little research. Corpus means body, Christi means Christ. In the Latin, that means the body of Christ. Is God not trying to shake up his church? Amen? So could it be that what's happening is actually a biblical thing? Yes, it is. Amen. Because one verse I've always loved was Hosea 4:6. Who knows what Hosea 4:6 is? My people will perish for a lack of knowledge. We have to know the Word of God. We have to know. We have to be in it. We have to have that fresh manna every single day. Well, Joel 2:31 says in the Old Testament, the sun will become dark. So see, these things that are happening is because it wasn't just a couple hurricanes. It was earthquakes and other continents, and everything was just happening so fast that everybody was talking about it, like, what's going on in this world today? And people were getting shaken up, and, you know, FEMA had to go help people, and that's great to have FEMA, but God didn't call FEMA. He called the body of Christ to help the people. And racial tensions were stirring, and people were feeling like, oh, I'm this color, you're that color, you're this side, you're that side. But you know what? If I'm the only person with a boat coming to save you in Texas, you don't care what color you are, just help me, take my hand, get me out of that. God had to shake up his church to show us that you need to go out there and be the body of Christ, even when it's difficult. I believe God is saying that we're called to be gatekeepers. But not only are we called to open up the gates of heaven, but also we're called to close the gates of hell. Amen? So in India, it is a country that is 1 billion Hindus. That's about 3 times the population of America. That's a lot of Hindus. And this is one of their idols that they carry through the streets. This was during a festival that was recent when me and Chinya were there. And it is madness. Loud, crazy, a little exciting, you know. But it's crazy. Also, most people don't know, but India is the second largest Muslim population. I see so many Muslims all the time over there, and I get to witness to them. And this is a slum, and I guess you could say this is a garden variety slum, because there's so many different kinds. A family of 5-10 people living in the size of some of our walk-in closets. They have homes where they live in where you can't even stand up. One night, I was in a slum, and we were praying. And I went in, the electricity was out, which is common in the slums. And when the electricity came on, what I didn't know was when I got up from kneeling and praying, is there was a fan like this high hovering. I almost hit it. If I would have been like tall American, finished. Okay, so there's a reason I'm not that tall, amen? Save me. I said, my golly, like in America we have fans that high. So it's very different over there. It's also, since last year, the sex traffic capital. Just to give you, for instance, there is like 2 to 3 million prostitutes that live in India. What do you think happens to the little girls that nobody's there to guard, to protect? There's 50 million orphans that live in India. 50 million. They say that if a mom is a prostitute, a sex traffic worker, then there is a 90% chance her daughters will do that work also. This is real. So 9 out of 10 girls whose parents are sex traffic workers will do the same thing. And it usually runs from ages about 12 to 15. That's the average. But I've seen little girls that I knew, in all their preciousness, get bogged for almost nothing at 5 years old, 6 years old. 7 or 8, they're already breaking them in, constantly raping them, burning them, beating them until they submit into their will. This is what happens for the kids that have nobody to fight for them, nobody to stand up for them. Because India is very different with a lot less red tape. This little girl, her name is Payo. Her mom got pregnant and she was not married. So in a village of India, that's a big no-no. Your family, they can end up killing the daughter because they shame the name, which is very common there because the police, not like here, you're gonna go to jail forever. You know, they can get away with a lot there. So the mom said, instead of ruining the name of my family and putting them to shame, I'll just kill the baby. So then one family ended up adopting the little girl. And so after about 4 years, when the girl was 4 years old, Payo, that family, they both found out that they were HIV positive. They were on their deathbed for about a year. So Payo went from house to place to room to here, and everybody just took her, but nobody really wanted her. She was a burden. And so they came to us and they asked us if we could take her. And unfortunately, we had to say, we're already in maximum capacity. We don't have room for any more kids and we have no finances to support her. What do you think the chances are somebody's gonna come along and take Payo, raise her in a godly family, and make her like a daughter? Slim. Here's another one. This is Shraddha. Shraddha's different than Payo because Shraddha's mom had her when she was 13 years old. Her mom's behind her. And what they did was they were beggars. And when they were hungry and didn't have any money, they would go through the trash cans. Well, in India, trash cans are no comparison to America trash cans. It's very, very different. Very different. Their trash system, they just throw out on the road, sits there, all the birds, there's, you know, the wild dogs are eating out of it, and it's madness. Not a place you want to be scrounging through. So Shraddha, she grew up a life of begging. Now, what do you think the chances are somebody's going to come along and going to help Shraddha out and raise her to know Jesus? Because her mom's a Hindu. What are the chances that she's going to feel loved and not rejected? That she's not going to look at the kids walking by with nice clothes and nice food eating and thinking, I wish I could be like that. In India, it's an impossible situation. There's no hope. That is without the Holy Spirit. So see, God has given us a strategy how to reach these kids, how to touch this nation, how to bring the presence and power of God, because we're living in the last days, so the power of God is no longer an option. It's vital. We need it. But why do so many Christians come against the gifts of the Spirit? Why do so many people talk bad about speaking in tongues and prophecy? Because it's the power of the church. You see, that's Satan trying to blind us, take the power away from us. The disciples were scared. They said, "No, Jesus, don't go. Please, please, please." And Jesus thought, they don't understand. He said, "Don't worry. I'm going to send you something better. See, I'm in the flesh. I'm limited. I can't go everywhere. But I'm going to send you the Paracletos, the Holy Spirit." Amen?
Yes.
I'm going to send you the Comforter. So when Jesus, when he rose from the grave and he came back and he was getting ready to lead them, he said, "I'm going to say the most important things, the things I do not want my people to ever forget, the things I've been pressing in, the things that I want to make most important. These are the things that you have to keep at the top of your mind." And he told them to go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and go to the ends of the world and preach the gospel. Then he said, "Go back to Jerusalem and wait for the power from on high." Now these guys were scared, right? They're like, "Don't leave." So one day they're worshiping, and the sound of a mighty rushing wind comes in. But what happened? Peter, the one who denied Jesus not once, not twice, but three times, he got up and he started to minister. Now he was no longer Peter the butcher. He was Peter the pastor. He wasn't cutting people's ears off. He was piercing through the hearts with the word of God. 3,000 people got saved that day. Amen? He was scared. He fled. See how the power of Jesus is? The Holy Spirit? Our strategy comes from Proverbs 22:6. It's a scripture that says, "Train up a child in the way that they should go, and when they are old, they will not depart." Our job is to give them God's word. But I love this scripture. I just came across, me and my wife were doing a family devotion a couple nights ago. And I just said, she said, "Okay, you can pick." I said, "All right, why don't we just do something random? How about Jeremiah 1? And I found this scripture, Jeremiah 1:12, that really hit me. It said, "The Lord said, I am actively watching over my word to fulfill it." That God watches over his word to make sure it comes to pass. You see, with these kids, I might not be able to buy them all a house. I can't buy them a car, but I can point them to Jesus. So now I want to show you a little video of the kids that, if they were not saved at our orphanage in India, it's very likely that they would have been sex trafficked, the girls. The boys would have been slave labor, which is very common in India. It's the capital of the world for slave labor. Kids at all ages just start working. I see them 5 or 6. They're out there trying to work, and they're sleeping at night. And even talking to the other Christians there, I said, "That's so sad that that little kid has to work. It's 10 o'clock at night, and they're sleeping." It's not sad. They got a job. They're making money. And I'm thinking, it should be different. But if we can just play that video, this is our orphanage in India.
Hello everyone, and welcome to the Children's Home in Delaware. We just
God's children, we're called to make history. Amen? Can I go back to that PowerPoint? Thank you, guys. So we started a ministry some years back. It's called Love Never Fails International. We do orphanage work. We do ministry in the slums where kids can come and they have a place where they hear the gospel and they feel loved. Because Jesus said, let all the children come to me. You know, don't keep them back. And so we had a little building. We started off with, we had 9 kids. This was a couple years back. And God just gave me a vision, and that was to go bigger and help more kids, but just trying to learn the basics of it, which was very tough, and how to work things out. There's a lot of details in that, as you could imagine. Well, how about that little girl, Pyle? Like I said, we were actually way over maximum capacity. We didn't have the finances to take care of any more kids, but by the grace of God, we took her in. So Pyle today is actually a very sweet kid. Here's her recent picture when I was just there. But it doesn't mean that, you know, she's not going to have challenges. But I can tell you that the life that she has today is night and day before I'm tossed around with all these different people, and she was just a burden to help out and house her for a little bit. Now she has a place. She has people to call mom and dad, house parents. And she has boys and girls that she calls brothers and sisters, and she's a daughter today. She's no longer an orphan because she has a family. And if I had my way, I'd adopt her and bring her here. That's how much I fell in love with her when I first met her. How about Shraddha? Shraddha's life wasn't really looking too bright at one point. But by God's grace, Shraddha was the first kid that we were able to take in. She's a very happy kid today. She's actually our smartest. She speaks the best English out of all the kids. She is reading the Bible. She can read the Bible. She's very familiar. These kids are not like unchurched kids. They're like super church kids because they go to a couple different things a week. We really put an emphasis on memorizing the Word of God. They know all kinds of worship songs. And it's just really a lot of fun to be around them to see their growth. When they worship with the depths of their heart. Because they know where they've been and they know about the goodness of God. Amen? And so, like I said, we had a vision that was to take in more kids. So when I was last here, we just started the building. We did the groundbreaking ceremony. So just to update you on that, as you look, here's our old building over here. Well, the new building is twice the size. And here is one of the latest pictures. That's when I was just there. And so, as you can see now, we have a lot more, and we're still working on it. We have inauguration, celebration set for November 15th. So I'll be back in India soon for that. If you want to come volunteer, please, I encourage you guys to pray about it, to consider it, talk with Pastor Michael. We're open 365 days a year. We're always in need of help. There's never an inconvenient time to come. You can always come. We're doing group trips now. And so with that new building, just like any building project you do, for most people I talk with, things come up. Things can change. So we ended up exhausting all of our funds, and then we needed a certain amount. Somebody really blessed us, but what's left now that we still have to raise to finish it is $3,642. Now, this is from the board because God gave me this idea to do a t-shirt fundraiser. We've never did any fundraiser before, let alone t-shirts. So it's $3,624. So it came up an idea for t-shirts. We're selling them for any gift of $20 or more. We have sizes small, medium, large, extra large, and double extra large. Okay, it's a vinyl print, so it's a really good material. Actually, we have a friend that makes t-shirts, so he hooked us up, but we would have to put in the day's work. So the first batch we made, it took us 7 hours to make 25, me and Chinese. And he's in his office, you know, doing all his other work, and come out when we make a mistake and help us to fix it. So it was an experience, but we have them today in the back. And if you buy a t-shirt, 100% of the profit is going to go to finish this orphanage. What do we need? We have to finish up the tiling, we need to finish up the windows, and we need to finish the painting. So the shirt says, this t-shirt built an orphanage in India. You're being a part of that, you're sewing into this ministry. You know, the blessings that come from that will go to you also, as you are a blessing to these kids that you saw. This thing looks a little bit blurry. It didn't look like that at home, but that's okay. So in 11 days, I'm going on a mission trip. I'm leading it to India to visit our centers. I'm taking a group of 7 people, and one of them is Tanya, the minister Tanya, who's minister here. I met her here, I think it was last year, and she said, God told me I'm going to India, and I believe it'll be with you. I said, amen, let's make it happen. And so, we're leaving on November 9th to November 20th. Please keep us in prayer. Here's some of the things we're going to do on that mission trip. Because I reached out to some people I know from living in India that would bring teams over, and they're like, oh yeah, we bring trips, and we like go to the mall, and we go, and we just watch people do things, and we just sit back, and yeah, I was like, that's not the vision God gave me, no. So, as soon as we go there, the first day, we're having a women's conference. Tanya's going to be leading that, she's preaching, she's on fire for the Lord. Then we have another lady that's a minister that she's traveling around the world ministering. She's going to be a part of that. We're going to have healing, deliverance, prophetic. And then afterwards, they're going to come up. We're going to pray. We're going to watch people get healed. We're taking God at his word. He said to go, heal the sick. He said to heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, and cast out demons. So we're going there to do that. It's going to be a hands-on. We also have a revival meeting, a prophecy, healing and deliverance meeting in the slums. We have a medical outreach we're doing. And we have a leaders workshop, a conference that we're leading. We're going to churches. We're ministering there. So we have an action-packed time. It is going to be all out fun. So another reason why I'm here today is because I can't do it alone, as you guys know. I hear from God, but I'm still very much human, like most of you, amen? So, Bible says that with one, we can win 1,000, but with two, we can win 10,000. That's why I'm here today also. See, many times you guys, as the body of Christ, you get treated like a hand or like a fork, because when the missionaries come or the ministers come, they want your funding, and you kind of get like, okay, here, please give. But really, you're more important than that, because God gave me a word from 1 Corinthians 12. It said, the parts of the body that are unseen are more important. In 1 Corinthians 12, Paul said that. You know, I've seen people live without an arm. They function. I've even seen people live without a leg. They function. But I've never seen anybody live without a heart, a set of lungs, a liver. Amen? Do not underestimate your worth. What impact you can have from sowing into a ministry. How you can help the gospel to go forth. I mean, there are some things I would say you have to check. You know, about finances. We're very transparent with our finances. We actually just recently got approved back in June by the ECFA, which is the number one Christian Accountability Association worldwide. So it's very extensive with them, and it wasn't easy to get in. It was a lot of work with our CPA working with them. We have all of our finances on the website too. So if you want to check that out, just so you can have some comfort, because I look at that when I give to a ministry, let me see their finances. Oh, they're not putting it. You know, what's going on? If you really want to help out, also we have child sponsorship available. So with that, it's $50 a month. You can sponsor a child. Now, I know there's ministries like World Vision and Compassion, and they're great, and they're $39 a month. Why are we $50? Because we're an orphanage. These kids at World Vision, Compassion, Gospel Fraser, they come for like an hour or two a day, and then they go back home. Our kids, just for their education, starting this year, I had to fight for this one, but I believe it was worth it, the kids are going to the best English school in the whole city. Now, for that, for each kid, it's a little over $100 a month. But I believe it's a great investment. Now, I would want that for my child. So why not for these? Because our belief is that this is not an institution for these kids. This is a home. You know, China can tell you that we really understand how these kids get treated. You know, we've had people leave before because they weren't following through. They weren't, you know, doing the things that was within the vision. And it's difficult because you don't have dime a dozen workers to come. So if you want to sign up, we have cards in the back with the kids' pictures and their bios and a sign-up sheet. And you'll get a packet from India from your child. You can also Skype with them in India. And here's another thing, which I never liked about some of those things because I supported children before. Oh, you can't visit them. Like, just let the option be there, right? Not like most of us are going to a third world country, but you can visit these kids. And you can come there. And like I said, we're open 365 days a year for your convenience. Mission trip. We are doing a mission trip in 2018 to India. The dates are July 3rd. I'm speaking Indian terms. We say 3. We say 3rd here. July 3rd to the 13th. Okay, I got flyers in the back. And if God called you, He can provide for you to go. Because everybody on this mission team now has raised their support. We also have brochures. Please take one of those. We have an email sign up. I'd love to see you sign up because this is a tiny little snippet this morning. And I'd love to let you know more of what we do, how we preach the gospel, and how these children's lives are being changed. And we need to increase our monthly support by $2,100 a month. Because with the new building and all the kids coming in, we're taking in 20 new kids. And so, that's it. Guys, thank you so much for having us here this morning. Pastor Michael, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. And hope to see you after the service. God bless.
Just give you a little bit of a background. We met them about, 3 years ago maybe? About 3 years ago. And at that time, Jonathan had just, you know, started the ministry, and it's only been a couple years in or so.
It's been about 7, but it seemed like it was just getting started.
Yeah. But the Lord hadn't gotten them to a place where they could come to the United States like this, to do this. So over the years, what's been so cool for Tiff and I, and for those that have been here, is we've seen the evolution of what God's doing. Went from just the centers to come here once a year if you're able to now God providing a staff, a team, volunteers, who allow for them to come more than once, to come and do the financial support and share about what God is doing and those kind of things. Not to mention, last year you were here, your building fund needed over $40,000. Now you're down to $3,000.
That's over that. So we raised that, and this was unexpected cost that came up. So it wasn't that bad. Not to mention, we had a $5,000 check come out of nowhere. I mean, which was really just praise the God.
So God's doing some amazing things. And you know what? As a church, one of the decisions we made in supporting missions is the missionaries we support, we want to have a relationship with. We want to know them. We don't just want to throw money at anybody or just take anybody. We're very selective and deliberate in who we support as a church. And we love Jonathan and Shine. They're awesome people. Not just because of their ministry, because of who they are. You know, their whole church is in touch and assembly of God when they're in the United States, but this is their second home as far as we're concerned, you know, and we're just so blessed. And we just reach out your hand. We want to just bless them right now. Lord, we just thank you, God, for this day. We thank you for the ministry and what you are doing in India, and thank you that we have this privilege of sowing into this, and being not just sowing, but being a part of this. In our prayers, Lord, in our relationship with Jonathan and signing, in sending out people to them, to Tanya might be going this time, but Lord, we just declare in your name that more from this body will come over the years to come as things continue to grow. Lord, we're saying thank you now for the financial support that is coming. I'm just going to call it out. I feel like in my spirit, by the time you go back to India, that 3,000 plus is going to be there. So Lord, they say thank you. We just bless what you are doing, Jesus. So thank you for that. And we just honor you. And just, Lord, we also want to ask a blessing on Shiny and Jonathan Chase as a family. That you bless them as a family apart from the ministry. The ministry is not who they are. They are a husband, a wife, and a son. And we pray and bless their family. And we bless them with time they need for themselves with you. Bless them with finances to meet their own family's needs, Lord God, and those who pour into them as a family. Yes, Lord, as they are refreshed, they're able to pour out. So we pray, God, that you would refresh them on a daily basis. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, just anoint them in the things they do. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God. You know, another thing, we weren't sure if Tanya was going to be here, but one of the things as a church, Tanya was seeking to purchase Bibles for the women's conference. And our church is giving her the money to do that. So she was hoping she'd be here to present her with that, but instead we'll mail it to her to make sure she gets it before she leaves. So we just want to be a part of what takes place there. So we're just so grateful. Would you stand up with me right now?